bifurcation, I think that the notion of bifurcation will give rise to different other notions related to what we have contributed all together. So Félix, I give you the room and you have more or less. Okay, Félix, please.
Okay, thank you, François, for the introduction. The idea of this talk is based on the fact that everybody knows that in fluid mechanics, Navier-Stokes equations is giving rise to a lot of bifurcations. And my point is that in solid mechanics, this is Coulombian friction, which is giving rise to various kinds of bifurcation. In few words, why Coulombian friction is leading to bifurcations? The important point is the fact that Coulomb friction is leading to a non-associated behavior. This is a very important question, and this non-associativeness of Coulombian friction is here immediately just with a box on a table. With a box on a table, you have just the normal stress, the tangential stress with the friction cone with the friction angle between the box and the table. And now, if you consider the displacement rates to have an idea about associativeness or not, and for example, in the normal direction, the tangential direction. Of course, the displacement is like that with not any normal displacement. It means immediately non-associativeness because if you have an associated behavior, the displacement should be normal to the plastic limit criterion. And this is the normality rule. Clearly, the normality rule is not at all verified just with the basic experiment of a box on a table. It means that essentially, Coulombian friction is connected to this question of non-associativeness. And it is possible to show in a very general way that non-associativeness imposes to the constitutive matrix, now I am coming back to continuum mechanics, non-associativeness is imposing to the constitutive matrix to be non-symmetric, while for an associated behavior, the constitutive matrix, in a very general way, is symmetric. And now, according to linear algebra, everybody knows that a non-symmetric matrix is leading to a lot of bifurcations with respect to a symmetric matrix. The basic point of this world of bifurcations linked to Coulombian friction is this question of non-symmetry of the constitutive operator. And I will try to illustrate this point.
If I can make a comment on this point.
Yeah.
Because what you showed now here for me is not the constitutive law. The constitutive law will go back to stress and strain. And for this we move from Coulomb to more Coulomb.
Yeah.
Wow. And it is not clear for me that when I move to more Coulomb, the non-associativeness is something which is obligatory. I'm not sure, because if I am associative, I have also dilatancy. It's maybe from experience.
Yeah, if you are associated, the question is that you will have a very strong associativeness.
Yes.
But I agree with you, of course, this box on the table is related to solid mechanics, not to continuum mechanics. My point was that even with the most simple experiment with Coulombian friction, you have non-associative behavior, even if for this box on the table it's a little bit schematic. Hein? Okay, I have always this first slide just to introduce elastoplasticity. For rate independent material, we have this constitutive relation between d sigma and d epsilon. Generally speaking, we have an incrementally non-linear constitutive relation. It means that the relation between d sigma and d epsilon is non-linear. The constitutive tensor is depending essentially from the direction of d epsilon or d sigma. And in a given tensorial zone, we have this incrementally linear relation. And now, if I want to describe failure in a very basic way, what means failure? What means perfect plasticity? It means a possibility to have finite strains for constant stresses. If so, if I want to describe this behavior, necessarily for in perfect plasticity or for all failure states, I will have this plastic limit condition linked to the singularities of the constitutive tensor M and associate in relation with the plastic limit condition, we have what is called plastic flow rule. And now I will show you how these notions defined in the framework of classical plasticity have to be generalized for non-associative behavior, have to generalize into what I have called the bifurcation condition and a failure rule. But before that, I have to show you that according to the experiments, indeed, we have plastic failure states which are not fulfilling these conditions, these classical conditions. The first example, which is very known in soil mechanics, this is a so-called underend triaxial compression, isochoric compression, triaxial compression with no volume variation because the sample is saturated by water and we close the drainage. And in a very classical way, we obtain this kind of diagram. The second stress invariant as a function of the first stress invariant with this, what is important is the fact that we have this peak here for the deviatoric stress, for the second stress invariant, which appear before the Moore-Coulomb limit condition, which is given by this straight line here. And here, the test is axially displacement controlled. But now, if this test is axially force controlled, you will not be able to go beyond this stress state with your triaxial apparatus, and you will have a brutal, sudden failure. And this failure is happening strictly before the classical plastic limit condition. And now what is interesting is the fact that if I introduce a second order work for axisymmetric condition, if I take into account the isochoric condition, you see that the second order work is just equal to dq d epsilon 1, what means that the second order work indeed is vanishing at Q peak. And we will see that according to Hill, this vanishing of second order work means that Q peak is unstable according to Hill relation. What is interesting is the fact that for axis symmetric condition, I can always write an elastoplastic constitutive relation like that by considering dq d epsilon v as function of d epsilon 1 d sigma 3. This is linked to the fact that these variables are conjugate with respect to energy. It means that these are proper loading variables and response variables. And now, for this undrawn paths, isochoric paths, no volume variation, the epsilon v, which is the volume variation in a small strain, is always equal to zero. And at Q peak, dq is vanishing. It means that you have here a clear generalization of the plastic limit condition given by the vanishing value of the determinant of n, what is called the bifurcation criterion, and you have a failure rule linked to this Q peak given by this relation. And what is interesting here, that's the fact that this is clearly not a flow rule, because you have a mixed relation between d epsilon 1 and d sigma 3. In classical plasticity, the flow rule is of course a relation between incremental strains. Here you have a mixed relation, and I have called this relation failure rule to distinguish to the classical notion of flow rule. Another example observe in the experiments since many years. Of course, these experiments have been conducted by Ali Dawaji, but this kind of results is very classical in soil mechanics. This is what is called Q constant drain loading paths. First, a drain triaxial compression, then you maintain Q constant by decreasing the mean stress. Q constant, and you decrease the mean stress. It appears since half a century that along this path, some failure states have been reached by the experimentalists before Moore-Coulomb criterion. And it appears, according to Dawaji experiments, that these failure states are linked to the maximum of dilatancy. Here, the peak, the extremum value of the main variable is not a stress variable as previously with Q. This is a strain variable. This is a maximum, an extremum for the volume variation. And indeed, if I come back to the second order work, for the undrawn loading, the epsilon v was equal to zero, and we have seen that the second order work is equal to dq d epsilon 1. Now, for Q constant drain test, the second order work is equal to d sigma 3, sigma 3 is the lateral pressure, d epsilon v, what means that indeed, the second order work is vanishing for the extremum value of epsilon v, as it was observed in the experiment. And by following the same reasoning, you see that you have this kind of constitutive relation for this axisymmetric condition, and indeed when dq is equal to zero at the extremum value of epsilon v, you will have a bifurcation criterion and a failure rule, and it appears that for both these tests, the bifurcation criterion is the same because this is the same matrix here. And indeed, we have been able to verify experimentally that both these criteria are identical. Okay, few words about this second order work criterion introduced by Hill, but Mandel, Bazin, Bruce, and so on have worked a lot on this criterion half a century ago, and the criterion is that you have a sufficient condition of stability if for any conjugate variable d sigma d epsilon, the second order work is strictly positive. What is interesting is the fact that if I consider the elastoplastic relation, if I put the elastoplastic relation in the expression of second order work, I obtain a quadratic form, and you know that according to linear algebra, if I decompose the matrix M into its symmetric part and its skew symmetric part, the quadratic form linked to a skew symmetric matrix is identically equal to zero, what means that the second order work depends only on the symmetric part of M, and now you have the classical discussion in associated elastoplasticity with symmetric matrix. The classical criterion we have seen is just coinciding with the stability condition as given by a second order work criterion, and both these conditions are identical. It means that the second order work criterion will not give new results with respect to classical elastoplasticity in the case of associated behavior, while in the non-associated elastoplasticity, both criteria are different. According to linear algebra, the determinant of the symmetric part of a matrix, if it is definite positive, is always vanishing before the determinant of the matrix itself. It means that we have a domain of bifurcations given by this hyper surface in the stress space, vanishing value of the determinant of the symmetric part of M, and the classical plastic limit condition, determinant of M equal to zero. It is also possible to show that the Rice localization criterion, when the Rice localization criterion is fulfilled, necessarily the determinant of the symmetric part of M is equal to zero or is taking negative values. What means that this condition contain all the other criteria. Since Hill, Mandel, and so on, two important new developments. The first one was the link between second order work criterion and burst of kinetic energies, that has been shown by François Nicot a few years ago. And indeed, according to the experiments, you have in mind that for failure of geomaterials, you are passing from a static quasi-static loading condition to a dynamic regime, which is indeed linked to this burst of kinetic energy. And second important result shown by a group of French mathematicians around Jean Lherbet, which is the fact that this criterion is valid for all failure by divergence instabilities. This result is also very important from a theoretical point of view, but also from practical point of view, because it appears that second order work criterion is a conservative criterion. It means that from an engineering point of view, when the second order work is not fulfilled, you will be perfectly stable with respect to what I have called diffuse failure, or what is classically called localized failure, which are all failure by divergence instabilities. Okay, now I have to go faster. Okay, this is an example, a generalization of what we have seen for the unwind isochoric condition and what we have seen for the Q constant Twain test by considering proportional strain paths with different direction according to R. Once more, I can write the constitutive relation like that. If I am considering these proportional strain paths, this generalized strain is always equal to zero. It means that if this generalized stress here is passing through an extremum value, you will have the classical discussion about bifurcation criterion and failure rule. It appears that the determinant of the constitutive matrix Q is vanishing when an equation of second degree with respect to R is fulfilled, and I will have real solutions for R if the discriminant is positive, and it means we are coming back to the general result. It means that the determinant of the symmetric part of M has to be negative. But when this condition is fulfilled, determinant of the symmetric part of M taking negative values, you will have two real solutions for R. It means that you will have a cone of unstable directions, which is a result absolutely classical according to linear algebra applied to a quadratic form. We know that for a quadratic form, we have always what is called in linear algebra an isotropic cone. Don't mix this question of isotropy according to mathematicians with our mechanical isotropy or anisotropy. Hein? This is fully independent. We are indeed showing here that we have this cone of unstable direction, and we have this failure rule, which is a mixed condition. Okay, here this is these strain proportional paths as obtained by an elastoplastic constitutive relation. This is the model I have developed many years ago, and incrementally fully incrementally nonlinear model, and indeed you see that for some value of R, our main variable is passing through through a maximum, and we are able to obtain in the axisymmetric stress plane the first point where the determinant of the symmetric part of M is vanishing, or where the second order work is vanishing for the first time. It means that this domain here between more Coulomb line given by the vanishing value of the determinant of the matrix from an analytical point of view, and this line linked to the vanishing value of the determinant of the symmetric part of M, this domain here corresponds to a bifurcation domain in compression, in extension. Here this is the first unstable direction obtained on the boundary of the bifurcation domain. Here you have the cone of unstable direction as planned by linear algebra. Inside this cone, you have negative values of second order work. Second order work is vanishing at the limit of the cone. I have these directions here correspond exactly to the roofs of the equation of second degree. So I have shown you just previously. Here, second order work is vanishing, inside negative value, outside positive values, and you see that we can have two cones, because in this constitutive model, that's possible to have different zones of linearity, if I can say, and according to the theory, for each tensorial zone, you can have a given instability cone. Okay, Pinstrom condition I pass, this is exactly the same kind of result. Here, this is a 3D condition. You see the cut of Moore Coulomb surface by a deviatoric stress plane, a P plane, and here this is the cut of the boundaries of the bifurcation domain. It means that in this zone here, we can obtain many bifurcations. Okay, this is these surfaces in 3D. Here, this is the cones in 3D. You see that you can have quite a complex landscape for these cones in 3D. Finally, we have three necessary and sufficient conditions for an effective failure. First, the loss of definite positiveness of the constitutive elastoplastic operator, which is exactly the second order work. It means that we have to be inside the bifurcation domain. The current loading direction have to belong to the instability cone, and third condition, of course, you have to consider a proper loading parameter for your loading paths. I will show you the link, because this is an important new result, the link between second order work and kinetic energy. This is the classical expression of the increment of kinetic energy as a function of the external work and the internal work in an Eulerian description, Lagrangian description, because we will have to differentiate with respect to time once more this this relation. And if we consider a Taylor expansion for the kinetic energy, assuming that we are on an equilibrium state just before failure, you see that if T is the time corresponding to failure, just after failure, you have this, we can call that the discrete second order work link to the loading applied to the boundary of the loading, minus the internal second order work, exactly in this Lagrangian description, exactly equal to the definition proposed by Hill. What means that in usual quasi-static condition, both these terms are equal. You have no burst of kinetic energy. If you have a vanishing value of the internal second order work as a function of the constitutive behavior of your material, and of course as a function of the loading path, it means that you are passing through an extremum of a given stress variable or a strain variable. When this this term is vanishing, if you continue to load a little bit your sample, this term will be positive, not not equilibrated by this term as previously in relation with the constitutive behavior of the material. You will have a strictly positive kinetic energy. It means a burst of kinetic energy. And we have checked that with a discrete element method in a very nice way. Here, this is the maximum value of Q, Q peak for Andrian condition, isotropic condition. We have seen that according to the experiments. The second order work is vanishing at Q peak. Hein? This is obvious. After Q, Q peak, the second order work is taking negative values. You continue numerically by applying the discrete element method. We continue to load the sample, the numerical sample, at its boundary. Like that, and you have here the value of the kinetic energy for all the grains inside inside the sample compared with the half of this quantity as defined previously. And indeed, you see that for a given time increment equal here to 0.08, the relation I have shown you previously linking kinetic energy and second order work is indeed fulfilled. Okay, we can compare with respect to instabilities, to bifurcation, to failure, associated materials and non-associated materials. Here we have a symmetric operator, non-symmetric operator. Here we have a single plastic limit surface. Here bifurcation domain delimited by both these different conditions, and you see that this is a big change in the paradigm of failure in geomaterials and generally speaking, in non-associate materials. Here we have the plastic limit condition, which has been, which should be replaced by the bifurcation criterion. And you have an infinite number of such criteria. And of course, in the axisymmetric condition, we have seen that we can have different bifurcation criteria according to the values of R, hein, in this very simple case of axisymmetric condition. The flow rule has to be generalized for a failure rule, and of course the necessary and sufficient condition for failure have to be generalized in this case. Okay, now I have just a few minutes and I will go fast. This is just an illustration of these results with a discrete element method. The advantage of discrete element method with respect to finite element method, this is of course the fact that discrete element method allows you to go to post-failure regime in a very natural way. With a finite element method, this is very difficult, more or less impossible, to reach this post-failure states, while in a discrete element method, this, this post-failure regime is described in a very natural way. We have a cubical specimen and so on. I have shown you that. I will not comment that. Okay, this is the question of the check with this DEM computation of the existence of the instability cones. You remember that according to the elastoplastic models, you have cones like that, which are indeed obtained with a discrete element simulation. We can check this question of control parameter. Hein, if I am, for example, for drawing triaxial paths, if I am axially displacement control, I have not any effective failure, while if I am axially force control, I will obtain this effective failure. Hein? This is a question of the choice, the proper choice of the leading parameter, the control parameter. This is the Q constant drain test we have seen from an experimental point of view at the beginning of this talk, simulated by a discrete element method. And you see that if the test is fully stress controlled, nothing happens, while when the same path is volumetric control, volumic control, control by the volume variation. We have seen that for a theoretical point of view, the instability will happen for a maximum value of the volume variation of the dilatancy. If we apply that exactly at the maximum of this volume variation, I have no more controllable stresses, burst of kinetic energy, strains suddenly growing. It means that we have indeed an effective failure observed in a discrete element simulation as predicted by the theory of second order work. Okay, here this is the this existence of instability cones. Lux-Sibyl has considered paths outside the cone, just at the limit of the cone and inside the cone, to see if failure occurs inside the cone and not outside of the cone. And indeed, the results are here. I am going fast. Huh? Inside the cone, this is for this direction, we have failure. Outside of the cone, for this direction, nothing. And just at the boundary of the cone, we have this erratic behavior, which is basically unstable. If I am talking about bifurcation states, it means that these states have to be sensible to perturbations. And indeed, it was interesting to see that if we are inside the cone or outside the cone, a perturbation can induce sudden failure of the specimen. The perturbation was just to give some finite velocity to the floating grains, because we have not gravity. There are always few grains without any contact with their neighbors. And indeed, the perturbation of kinetic energy is so small that you cannot see on the figure. And once more, inside the cone, the perturbation is inducing this sudden burst of kinetic energy. Outside of the cone, nothing, and at the boundary of the cone, we have some variation in the kinetic energy, but finally a final state. This is the conclusion. Okay, I have 3 minutes of delay. Huh? Oh. Bon, Bernard.
Very good synthesis, Felix. I have a question on the second order work at the local level, that is to say at the
yeah.
level. I think that you have a few years ago some difficulties to have the correlation between this local level and the something new.
Excellent question. I will ask François to answer, because this is typically one of his main results. Hein?
Yeah. To excellent point. 5 years ago, we tried to correlate the local second order approach with the relative displacement, and the contact force. And it appeared that the correlation was not very good, not satisfying. And then I came back to this issue, and I showed that the right correlation is not between the contact force and the relative velocity, but between the contact force and the variation in the branch vector.
And so?
And the change in the branch vectors joining the two centers of the contacting grains. So in this approach, in fact, what you have to take into account is the change in the geometry, but not the fact that the grains can rotate. Because if you take only into account the branch vector, you disregard the rotation of the grains. So it was strange to me, but when we checked this point numerically, then we showed that the correlation was very good between the two computations of the second order graph, from macro variables or from micro variables.
It means that now we have a very consistent landscape.
In the stress definition, there are the branch were good.
Yes.
So perhaps it is okay.
It is, you're right, because in the demonstration I started from the formulation, from the Loewe-Weber formulation, then starting from the branch vectors. And then after some computation, because the demonstration is not so evident, huh? But after some computation, then you can obtain these new results.
Okay, thank you.
Jim?
Very naive question, because I have quite a lot. It seems for me that in the paper of Hill, there is clearly a distinction between uniqueness, bifurcation, and stability.
Yeah.
And it seems for me that sometimes you use second order work as an instability condition, and for me it's a uniqueness condition.
Yeah, this is a good question. You know that Hill sufficient condition of stability has been used by many researchers. Hill has distinguished clearly uniqueness condition from a stability condition, and for me now, I consider that when the second order work is fulfilled, when the medium is unstable, and if the three necessary and condition for failure is obtained, you will have loss of uniqueness. But you see, the loss of uniqueness is not linked only to the second order work. As Hill has shown, this is only a sufficient condition of stability. But of course, if these three necessary and sufficient conditions for failure are fulfilled, you have loss of uniqueness, as it is classical.
We have some comparison in damage mechanics. You have loss of uniqueness, but you can fold some stable person.
Yeah.
So it's not unstable.
Yeah.
After that, you lost the stability.
Yeah.
And you go to spend damage.
Yeah, there are a lot of confusion because the people are considering that, some people are considering that if the second order work is fulfilled, you will have failure. No, you have three necessary and sufficient conditions to be fulfilled. And particularly, the question of the proper choice of the control parameter is very important. Hein? Even if you are in the bifurcation domain, even if the second order work is fulfilled, as for the drained triaxial compression, you can observe not any failure, effective failure. It means that you will have not at all loss of uniqueness. This is a little bit intricate.
Felix, when you talk about uniqueness, it is uniqueness of what? It is uniqueness of the static problem.
Huh? This is the Hill condition for
the
Hill condition, second order.
The loss of uniqueness of the static problem. And when we have failure, then as shown by Felix, we have a transition from a quasi-static to a dynamical regime. And then, automatically, you lose the uniqueness for the static problem. Because you are not able to solve the static problem. The static problem has no solution, or has no unique solution. Just because the problem is no longer static, but
it's dynamical. I use Hill condition. Hill condition is a loss of uniqueness. Now, if I want to go to stability, is there another problem?
Mm-hmm.
Stability problem is not the uniqueness problem. So for me, the sequence is loss of uniqueness, instability, and localization.
Yeah.
In this one, even in the case of non-associated classes, because this has been shown by Wicker and Meyer, Ranicki and Bruns, there is some paper on this.
Mm.
The uniqueness condition for me is clear.
Yeah.
Stability is other things.
Yeah, you have seen that I have carefully distinguished between the fact that failure implies loss of uniqueness, loss of stability, loss of bifurcation, but the reverses are not true. Hein? The reverses are not true. Yeah. Okay, we are late. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you.